IVM.
Hi, I'm Satyajit.
Hi, I'm Racheta.
Welcome to Paperback by the Open Library Project.
We have as our guest today Zarina Poonawalla, peak performance coach, life coach. In the first half, we discussed the book Reject Me, I Love It by John Furhnam, which we deep dive into the first half of the podcast.
In the second half, we also discuss The Last Lecture by Randy Pausch, 60-Second Time Out by Mike Greene, The Mastery Manual by Robin Sharma, People's Tools by Alan C. Fox, and The Jack Welch Way by Stuart Cranier.
Zarina discusses fear, rejection, vulnerability, and acceptance of our strengths and weaknesses, amongst other things that would help build a strong foundation for entrepreneurs and for their personal development.
Happy listening.
Rejection, avoidance is dangerous. Have you ever had an idea that could have accelerated your success, but you didn't take advantage of it because you wanted to avoid rejection? Here's an example. There was a man who lived every day with one consuming dream: to become an actor. All he needed was a part to play. Undaunted, his dream drew him to write his own part. He put together a script and began looking for someone to produce it. He went from agent to agent and studio to studio. But no matter what he did, nothing came of it. He was turned down over 1,000 times. Even if he had given up here, most people would have still called him courageous because he kept going on in spite of all the rejection. But what's not the end of the story is that finally somebody liked his script. The timing couldn't have been better. He was flat broke. Yet because his dream was to be an actor and it was so great, he turned down the $25,000 he was offered to pay for the script. The producer wanted someone else to play his part. He kept searching until he got exactly what he wanted. Eventually, starred in the movie he wrote and won an Oscar. It was then followed by 4 sequels. For holding on to his dream and turning down the initial $25,000 buyout, he now gets several million dollars per picture. What would have happened if Sylvester Stallone had rejected this particular idea? And nobody would have ever known who Rocky was.
Thank you, Zarina Poonawalla. That was an excerpt from the book Reject Me, I Love It by John Furhnam. We'll be right back after this to discuss the book in more detail.
Hi, my name is Anupam Gupta. I'm B50 on Twitter. I am the host of Paisa Paisa, the show that talks money. On my show, I speak to experts from every field of money and finance, from stock markets, equities, debt funds, credit cards, life insurance, every possible area of money and finance that you can think of. We even did an episode on cryptocurrency. I've got fantastic guests from mutual funds to personal finance experts everywhere. Robo-advisory, startups, just name it, we've got it. At Paisa Paisa, we help you make smart decisions about money. You work hard for money. Now make your money work hard for you. New episodes out every Monday, and you can listen to my show on the IVM podcast app or any other podcasting app that you have. Paisa Paisa is brought to you by Paytm Money.
Welcome to Paperback by the Open Library Project. I am your co-host Satyajit, otherwise known as Onion Knight in most food circles. I'm hosting this podcast with my co-founder at the Open Library Project, Racheta Sharma.
Hi guys, my name is Racheta and I'm an ex-banker who gave up my banking profession to follow my passion and run libraries across the world. The Open Library Project is a non-fiction book library service offered to businesses on a subscription basis. We're trying to move away from the run-of-the-mill library concept and setting up rotational and locational curated libraries at co-working spaces, corporates and business incubators. The idea here is to create value, build a knowledge community and encourage a growth mindset amongst our members.
Today we have with us on the show Zarina Poonawalla. Zarina is a life coach, executive coach, speaker and educator. She is founder of Abzo Expertise Unique, established in Mumbai, India, which constantly thrives on learning and evolving to benefit individuals and organizations worldwide. In her professional capacity, Zarina has worked closely with founders, entrepreneurs, CEOs, business honchos, management gurus, families, individuals, parents and student communities across the world for over a decade. The very essence of her programs are self-realization, potential maximization, positive state of mind and embracing happiness. She also hosts the podcast, The Empowering Series with Zarina, which is available wherever you listen to podcasts. Welcome to the show, Zarina.
Thank you so much.
Lovely to have you here.
Racheta and Satyajit, thank you so much for having me on your show.
It's great to have you on the show and, you know, a little bit of history between all three of us.
With some roles reversed, actually.
Roles have completely been reversed. Zarina was one of the first people to have me individually as well as Racheta individually
on my podcast.
I think that's going to be releasing very soon. So we're very excited for that.
Me too. I think we'll probably have overlaps and people will be listening to the three of us a lot more.
That sounds really good.
Yeah. So that's great.
Getting back to the excerpt that you read out from the book, mm-hmm. Reject Me, I Love It. Mm-hmm. What a fantastic excerpt, by the way. I was wondering who this person
is. Right.
And so tell us a little bit about this book, Zarina.
So basically, I have come across this book. This is an old book. It's not very new. It's not lately published.
Okay. Right.
So it doesn't have the most insightful, latest innovative ideas, but it's got these deep foundational thought processes, you know, to do with rejection, motivation, acceptance. So I kind of just had this, I looked at the title and I loved it when I saw it at a crossword, you know, just Reject Me, I Love It. That just sounds
stands
so
out.
It just stands out, right? So I came across this title and I was like, I need to read this. So I started going through it, sitting at our famous crossword and a couple of years ago. And then I just got really deep into this book and I realized that most of the things that we go through in life are choices we make out of the rejections that we go through a lot of times.
Yeah.
Now, either you grow from it or you crush yourself from it. So the whole concept really helped me to elaborate, understand, and then use it insightfully in my programs.
Okay.
Because most people that I coach or meet, they usually have issues with self-acceptance or, you know, the fear of judgment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, I do fear judgment because you're worried you'll be rejected, you know, on the way you look or the way you work or the way you appear or just speak or several other reasons. So I just like the whole idea so much that it actually works well even for a lot of modules that I do.
Okay.
Rejection.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think we are all programmed with that basic fear of rejection as human beings, right?
And we've spoken about it time and again on our podcast about, you know, like this being a real issue with entrepreneurs to accept that, you know, you can fail and maybe your thought process can go wrong, you know.
Not just fail. In fact, I'd like to reference something else here. There's a show on Netflix by Brené Brown. It's on vulnerability.
Yes,
and she says you don't need to accept that you may fail. Yeah. You need to accept that you are going to fail multiple times. And you need to learn to deal with it over those failures to become a better person instead of letting them crush you, right? I think
it's very interesting that, you know, she said, like she says that neurologically we are wired to sort of reject stuff that we know would hurt us.
Right.
So there are certain things with which our brain, you know, sort of realizes that, you know,
it's familiarized with certain things.
You're familiarized with certain things and you
that's your first reaction anyway.
This could cause you pain.
Yeah. But, you know, the idea of rejection comes from this. When, I mean, the one of the very first things he's mentioned in his book, John Furhnam, and he's been in the automobile sales industry for many, many years, and then he got into writing.
Yeah.
And I think some of my best and favorite books come from salespeople.
Right. Yeah.
Because the way they understand rejection, nobody does. Nobody does. And I also think that we all, in our own spaces, have to sell ourselves, have to sell our products, our services so often to survive, to grow, that it's just simply a part of the way you are on a daily basis. You're going to see rejection every day in some way. But the one thing that he explains in this book, at the very beginning, in fact, is that the whole idea of a human being, the idea of procreation is rejection.
Exactly.
You're thrown out of your mother's womb and that's how you learn how to survive.
Okay.
You know, you're literally thrown out of a human body. Yeah. You're rejected from a human body.
Yeah.
Any mammal does that. Even amphibians. So any animal, you know, whether you're saying a hen is laying eggs or a woman is giving birth, it's rejection.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So the way he explains that is it just tells you that your life starts with rejection.
Yeah.
There is no way out. There is no way out. You have to be rejected initially to be able to understand what is going to take you forward or make you kind of increase the way you are looking at yourself or elevate your mind.
Right.
You know, so I just truly understand that concept very it's close to my heart.
Yeah.
I guess we've all been rejected.
Definitely.
Yeah, of course.
many times.
Yes. It's all about accepting that it's okay and letting yourself feel joy.
True.
You know, a lot of times we don't let ourselves enjoy, you know, a happy moment or joy because our first reaction is everything is going so well, what's going to go wrong?
Right.
Know? But it's all about just letting yourself enjoy that moment.
Yes.
In fact, in the book, he's used an abbreviation for success, which I'd like to share with our listeners. So, success and how it stands for. S is for self-evaluate, where he talks about, you know, doing a SWOT analysis of yourself and finding out your strengths and weaknesses. And then U is understand each task. So, you focus yourself on every task at hand. Then comes care, that's caring about your dreams and goals, concentrating on the results. E is to expect, that you have to want to succeed. That's, you know, that's the minimum expectation you should set for yourself. C, which is like feel and imagine your dream, which also a lot of books talk about that, you know, the first way to,
affirmations, visualizations
focus
and dream
and actually getting to your goal.
Right.
And then share it with the ecosystem. So it's beautifully defined. I think that's what success entails. So,
yes,
I love it.
It just envelops the whole idea of success very differently because I think nowhere in this book does he mention success is equal to money.
Right.
Yeah.
You know,
right.
It's not materialized.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you could be successful if you're bad with time management and you've reached a space in time.
Mm-hmm.
That's success for you today.
Exactly.
You know, as simple as
that.
Yeah. Or
if you've bettered yourself in any way, constantly working on it, that's a success for
you.
Right?
I mean, if you decided you just kept telling yourself, I don't know how to boil water.
Yeah.
And you decided to boil water without spilling it, burning yourself, or being able to switch on that gas. For God's sake, that's success for you.
Of course.
Yeah. So success doesn't... So what really happens here is we tend to define success in this little box.
Yeah.
It's equal to fame, it's equal to glamour, it's equal to money.
Mm-hmm.
But that's not exactly the definition of success. And that's why, you know, when he talks about the ecosystem...
Yeah.
In his definition of success, it simply tells you that it's not material. It doesn't have to be.
Right.
Yeah, it's benefiting others with what you've benefited
absolutely,
from.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And, you know, you're a life coach. Hmm. So your people, like you said, must be coming to you all the time with, you know, how to face rejection and deal with it. So what are the tips you give to sort of use it to your advantage? Use rejection to
your
advantage.
Because this must be one of the, you know, top priorities people need to learn how to deal with, right?
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
Actually, most people come to you, they don't find themselves rejected or demeaned. But most people come with that fear of judgment.
Yeah.
Of the fear. See, you know, rejection is not the worry.
Yeah. Right.
The fear of rejection is the worry for people.
Right. Yeah.
So the one way that you actually deal with this is probably just accepting who you are, what you're capable of, and what you can grow into.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Secondly, you have to worry a little bit just to the extent that people get your message, understand your communication. If you're public speaking, you're talking to an audience, your communication or message must be understood. If you're delivering a presentation, the presentation must be understood. So that much worry is okay. That causes nervousness. That can lead to being confident and not overconfident.
Right. Yeah.
Correct?
Yeah.
So that's good. Yeah. That's not bad. However, the minute that worry becomes too much, to the extent that what people are thinking about me.
Yeah.
So you don't take rejection personally.
Yeah. Right.
You know, the idea of dealing with rejection is not to take it personally.
Mm.
Analyze your situation.
Yeah.
Introspect a little bit. Understand whether this was about you. This was about the situation. Maybe you're really good, but maybe the situation isn't.
Yeah. Right.
Maybe you're... it's not a conducive environment for people to take this particular idea and make it big currently.
Right.
Like so many times, you know, we come up with an idea, it can be amazing, but the market may reject it.
Absolutely.
So, you know,
it doesn't mean the idea was bad or you were bad at running the
idea.
Maybe
the
times were wrong.
Yeah.
There could be a multitude of reasons why things did not work out.
For me, the top reason for things not working out for us is because those things that have been rejected eventually always work out. It's never an idea, a thought, or a person who's rejected, somebody is going to accept you. Mm-hmm. Somebody is going to love what you've done. Somebody is going to love your idea.
Yeah.
It's about timing.
Right. It's a lot about timing.
It's a lot about timing. So, and I also believe that, you know, you take a decision and you make it right. So yeah. when you're rejected, it's okay to be rejected.
Yeah.
You know, decide that, okay, it's fine. Let's move on. Let's figure out the right time to make this work for us. Mm. And the minute that moment clicks for you, there's no looking back.
Yeah.
I mean, most success stories come out of rejection, actually. So.
Definitely. I think one of the things that we also discuss at times is that really the driving factor for some people or for a lot of successful people has been that people have told them that beta tumse na ho paega, tum chhod do, right?
Right, yeah. right.
And that is, I've seen it across a lot of people. Like, this person told me I'd never be able to do it. So right. now I did it. But then I did much more than I set out to do even at that moment in time.
Yeah.
So, like, rejection can drive a lot of success, I feel.
So, that's right.
Then again, you know, I feel like this can be... this should not be personal. That you know, you're trying to prove a point to someone.
Absolutely not. Yeah. Absolutely not. And if there's anything you're proving to anybody, it should be you.
To yourself.
Yeah. You start with yourself. Yeah. So since you mentioned... Satyajit. I'm used to. Okay. So, since you mentioned that, it can drive people. There's this entire chapter on rejection and how it can motivate you.
Right. Yeah.
So, the multiple times that you get rejected, if you look at rejection positively, it's just a matter of a shift in your brain, you know? You just change your attitude a little bit and you look at rejection like, hey, okay, fine, I got rejected. That means something's working out for me. Yeah. Let me try again.
Right. Mm.
Instead of looking at it as, hey, you know, I got rejected. Now there's nothing I can do with my life and I'm a loser. Yeah. So the minute you change that little attitude within and you start looking at every rejection as a stepping stone.
Yeah. Right.
Instead of looking at it as something taking you down the grave and burying you in a well, then you're going to be able to find motivation.
Definitely.
So it also gives you a brief understanding of how pressure works, you know, to motivate people.
Yeah.
So there's amazing something he's written in his book about if you watch space movies, you realize that because there is so much vacuum in space, and any space movie, one protagonist will die.
In space.
Yeah. In space. In space. They always show somebody dying in space. And when that person is going to die in space and his, you know, his cover is off and, you know, his suit is off, he's going to blow up and blast.
Yeah. yeah.
Why? Because he's in space.
Yeah. Right.
Earth gives you pressure.
Right.
Yeah.
To stay within your physical boundaries.
Yes. So, you know, there's an amount of importance of pressure, importance of rejection. All the words that we've been using so negatively around us, they have a very positive understanding in this this entire book. And because pressure, rejection, these things, they kind of, they're two sides of a coin.
Yeah.
As long as you can deal it with it and have a good attitude towards things, they just work out just completely fine, you know.
Yeah, I think it's so like Satyajit mentioned, even in the Brené Brown talk, it's about, you know, she says that you have to sort of, even when you're dealing with someone who's feeling rejected,
right.
you have to tell them that, you know, this is what I understand when you say this to me.
Right.
Instead of being like, you know, oh, this is the conclusion I'm taking from what you've said.
Right.
So you go like, you know, my story. Which I have made up from, or my conclusion that I made up from what you say is this. So which makes them feel much more approachable. Like, you know, they can come to you and talk to you about what they feel or their fear. So, yeah, a lot to do with your perspective and your approach, I guess.
Yes, too much to do with it, actually.
It's really, I think, it's everything to do with perspective because... Yeah. I remember taking it very personally when, you know, I used to work in the transport sector and my job was dealing with drivers on a daily basis and convincing them that, you know what, I know your time's up, but why don't you go do some overtime? So I spent 7 years of my life doing that. And literally those 7 years have taught me of how to take a no.
Right.
Yeah.
And then accept it. And then convince that person to change that no into a yes into for today. Just for today.
Just for today.
You don't have to do it tomorrow. You don't have to do it later in the week.
You'll have to do it every day.
But that's what I do every day. And and honestly, that rejection that I had so early on in my life has really given me the wherewithal to deal with situations today where we are constantly, people are always telling me no because I'm an entrepreneur with some wacky ideas.
Correct.
So people are always saying that, you know, this
then
is...
Then you're in the right direction when you get those many no's.
But yeah, it's that rejection that I took in maybe in my earlier years, mm-hmm. that now I'm very well versed to deal with rejection and, you know, convert it to a positive sort of feeling. So right. I love the title of this book. I love that we're talking about rejection.
Yeah, no, there's one thing he's mentioned here is that, I mean, there's a little story about two old men.
Okay.
So one is doing extremely well for himself. He's a billionaire. So the other one, he's digging ditches for a train tunnel, basically. So there's a young fellow working with this old chap. And he says, I saw you yesterday with that billionaire guy.
Yeah.
You know, you were having dinner with him and you walked out and you got into a nice fancy car.
Yeah.
How come? Who's he? So this guy says that he's my friend, you know. We started off together digging ditches just like these.
Okay.
And he's my friend and we often do meet up for, you know, dinner or just a supper or so. So that young chap asks him that, okay, how come he's there? And you're here.
Yeah.
And his response is, it's quite interesting because he says he came here to work for the company. I came here for $1.50 per hour. That's the difference between him and me.
Yeah.
Okay. I came here just to make that money.
For the money.
Yeah.
And he came to actually work.
Yes. Okay, well, he came to work for the company. So similarly, even there's a John F. Kennedy story where somebody's cleaning up, you know, like a janitor's cleaning up before Neil Armstrong is off to the moon.
And
he says, yeah, I'm sending a man to the moon. He doesn't say I'm just
cleaning the floor.
He says, I'm sending a man to the moon, you know.
In a purpose-driven company, it's like, you feel part of that mission.
Absolutely. And I think when you... and it's not always the boss or the leader or the entrepreneur's responsibility to make you feel like that. It is also your responsibility to understand where you see yourself in an organization, by yourself, if you're running your own business.
Right.
Or if you want to do nothing with all of that and you want to probably just, you know, become a yogi also.
Yeah.
You decide how you want to do it, but then achieve that goal. You can't just... throw the entire ball in the employer's court and say, okay, they are responsible for making us motivated and, you know, like doing this and that. You have to take certain amount of decisions and change the approach. So these stories, you know, they really tell you about how two people in the same situation can give you such...
can deal with it so differently.
Yeah, so I guess that also kind of poses to the whole rejection aspect then, you know.
On that note, we're going to take a short break and we'll be right back after this.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to another awesome week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you are not following us on social media, please make sure that you do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. We'd like to thank the sponsors on our network, Storytel, Savari, and Paytm Money for their support, and really appreciate it. It's been a busy month at IVM. Last week, we launched three new shows. We launched ADKT Talent Tent, we launched Business.next in partnership with Bloomberg Quint, and we launched Equity Sahi in partnership with Motilal Oswal. And this week, we're going to bring back an old favorite. We're going to come back with the Empowering series after a fairly long hiatus. I hope that you guys enjoy that. Life coach Zarina Poonawalla is joined by our co-founder Kavita Rajwade to discuss how you can put your game face on at your workplace. On Cyrus Says, media pioneer and first-generation entrepreneur Ronnie Screwala shares his journey with Cyrus, from humble beginnings to small steps in business to going on to establish UTV, RSVP, and more. He also sheds light on his theater days, his parents, and his new podcast, the Ronnie Screwala Podcast, right here on the IVM Network. On Simplify, join Chuck, Naren, and Shrike at Simplify the Black Holes and their importance in this universe. Vishvesh Kuttal joins Pawan and Ganesh on Thale Harate, a Kannada podcast, to talk about his life as an associate professor at the Indian Institute of Science in Bengaluru. On the Pragati podcast, V. Ravichandra joins host Pawan to share his experience of working with governments and sheds light on the challenges and constraints faced by government agencies, bureaucrats, and politicians. On Croc Tales, Anna narrates tales on the theme of Avengers Endgame. What would the endgame be in a layman's life? On the Sponge podcast, Ambi Parmeshwaran talks about the importance of demonstrating a greater degree of trust in a client and agency relationship. On IVM Likes, Abbas and Abhineet are joined by the main cast of TVF's new series, Kota Factory. They give insights about the show and the inspirations of the writers and actors. On Echoes of India, Anirudh takes us on a tour through the ancient city of Ujjain, walking us through its sights and smells and introducing us to some of its eccentric people. And with that, let's move on with your shows.
Welcome back, guys. We still have with us Zarina Poonawalla, and we're going to be discussing a few more books. The first book that we're starting with is The Last Lecture by Randy Pausch. So, Zarina, tell us a little bit about this book.
So, Racheta and we were discussing it, and I guess we have an understanding. So, Randy Pausch was a professor at Dale Carnegie.
Okay.
and he suffered pancreatic cancer.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then he gave a last lecture,
okay,
you know, to his students,
yeah,
on probably how to fulfill your dreams, you know, how you need to focus on your goals, focus on the good things in life and so on and so forth. And that he made into a book.
Yeah.
Okay.
And it became a book. In fact, it's also quite famous. It's a video as well. Mm-hmm. If you go on and you'll see, oh, you'll okay, actually find this video on the last lecture.
Okay.
So he has three children and he has a wife and the perfect mm-hmm. life. And then suddenly he's hit with this news,
mm-hmm.
you know, that he's got a couple of months to live.
Yeah.
So he puts it across very nicely. And his doctors and people around him have been very supportive.
Mm-hmm.
So he uses this one phrase somewhere in his book where he says semantics are so important. You know, like yeah, the way you put across messages, the words yeah, you're using. So instead of saying that you're going to die in 3 months or 3 to 6 months, he was told that you have 3 to 6 months of good health.
Hmm.
Okay.
Okay. So that made him feel like, hey, you know what? I'm not dying until I'm dead.
Right. Yeah.
So I'm just going to spend those 3 to 6 months
yeah,
living normally, doing normal things. And basically just the idea of somebody living his end
mm-hmm. yeah,
and being able to project positivity and give you life lessons so beautifully
mm-hmm.
that the idea just kind of struck to me. And it's beautiful. The book is beautiful.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's great how, you know, so the last lecture is called Really Achieving Your Childhood Dreams.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And he essentially is talking about that, you know, you don't have to know how to achieve your dreams, but you have to learn how to live your life while you are working towards your dream.
Right.
And a very striking part for me in the book is where when he's talking about his childhood
mm-hmm.
and he says that his parents, you know, always allowed him to paint his dreams on his wall.
Yes, yes.
So his bedroom wall mm-hmm. always had whatever dreams he had painted on it.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, like we spoke about visualization and, you know, there's Secret by Rhonda Byrne and
right,
Big Magic. These books also talk about, you know, sort of imagining your dreams so that you can
right,
reach your goals. So it's very cool. And, you know, one of the things that he mentioned was that he had painted his dream of floating in zero gravity.
Okay.
Which he finally did achieve
right,
before he died.
He died. Yeah.
And at that point, when he must have painted it, it was just one of the most random dreams.
Impossible
you know?
So, dreams, yeah, actually.
Yeah. You know? You should dream these impossible dreams.
Yeah.
And
in fact, in the World Book Encyclopedia,
mm-hmm.
he has also got an entry for virtual reality.
Yes. Oh.
So it's just amazing how he dreamt these things.
And he made it happen.
Happened.
They actually
yeah,
happened. And yeah, so I think, you know, what the book makes me feel is that you should always have a bucket list.
Yes, mm-hmm. you must.
And no matter how crazy it sounds, you should take that as a compliment and you should really yeah, work towards
you use that rejection from people, make
yeah,
your bucket mm-hmm. list
make
your
bucket
and go
list,
on
yeah,
and
yeah,
kind of dream big and make
yeah,
it happen.
Yeah.
The fact about dreaming big and making mm-hmm. things happen is when they actually happen, you know, you worked so hard in the process that mm, you don't see it as a dream anymore.
Right.
You yeah, see it as reality.
Right.
And that's why that whole the whole picture that you painted, you know, suddenly when you see things working out and coming, mm-hmm. you're like, did this really happen with me?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I've,
yeah,
I've
you
felt
had those
that
moments,
a couple
yeah,
of times
yes,
and more than
yes,
a couple
me
of
too,
times. And it's just, sometimes I just take a step back and I'm like, is this really my life? Like, is this really happening right now from like 3 years ago, 4 years ago,
right,
what I had imagined?
Right.
Like, I can't believe it's actually come into reality.
Yeah, and like, you know, there's that saying that when
yeah,
when you look at everything, nothing's changed. And then yet everything has changed.
Yeah,
yeah.
Okay, so
yeah,
that's exactly what you feel when you're getting closer to your dreams. And just the idea of him being so positive, you
yeah,
know, sharing his dreams and in fact fulfilling them
mm-hmm.
before he passes mm-hmm. away.
Yeah.
So he's not passed away at 80.
Right.
Yeah.
He's not, he could have lived a couple of more years.
Mm.
So you know how people usually give time as an excuse, age and as an excuse to
yeah,
not fulfill or be purposeful.
Mm-hmm.
That he defies completely in his book.
Yeah.
So a great book, I think, for
yes,
a lot of people who are aspirational and want
totally,
to really conquer the world.
Yeah.
Next book that we're moving on to is The Mastery Manual by Robin Sharma.
Right. It is.
So Mastery Manual is again
It's basically, I think he talks about 36 modules.
He does.
Which, talk about personal and professional development.
Absolutely.
So what I really like about this book is that it's very in sync with The Power of Now by Eckhart Tolle.
Right.
So again, it talks about, living life to the full at that moment, because that moment is your, it's the truth.
Right.
And that's it. This is what you have. What you did is not going to make a difference. And what you will do will be dependent on what you do today. So it's just about really being in the now. And I like how he's used, that you should just snip off anything that's not going to contribute to your now. So if you feel that there's something happened in your past and it's not going to, really contribute to your now, then it's something you need to cut off and
completely.
Move on and find a better now for yourself.
Right.
So, what about the book is, it really stands out for you?
For me, the fact that there are certain excerpts in the book where he's actually considered himself as a regular human being. So although this is a mastery manual, he's very clear about the fact that he's not mastered anything himself. And he's very clear about the fact that I'm still learning in the process as well. So it gives you this understanding that, people who are preaching to you or, in my kind of work, you're coaching people. So you're often asked that, do you really even follow what you say?
Right.
And, this whole positivity act and all that jazz. And you're like, hello, I don't think you're in a position to not follow it if you're sitting and having to listen to people's negativity.
Yeah.
As simple as that.
That's a good one.
That's really on point.
It's as simple as, it's a mandate.
Yeah. Right.
It's a choice, it's a mandate. And I think you kind of sync those two together. And I think Robin Sharma explains those things very beautifully. Like, he just puts this across as your life is not great things. It's just smaller things in a string of pearls, and he just says it so beautifully. So, and he's got amazing lessons to share. So I believe the way he just approaches the topic of life subject. So there's a practicality. He's pragmatic about the fact that, divorces and financial issues, crunches, all these things happen. Now, how are you going to deal with it? Let's talk about that. So I guess it's helpful for people to at least give one or two chapters a good read and try and use them.
Right.
And it's very in line with what you and we do.
Exactly.
Like, you talk about, how you should sort of live your life better, and you're giving people training on, dealing with difficult situations and continuously learning, getting better with, what you've aimed for yourself.
Right.
And that's something the library also attempts to do. And I think Robin Sharma also has very nicely mentioned how you can be a life learner. So he talks about, that you should read a book every day. And he's like, in fact, most top performers read one book in a day. So, if you think that without continuous learning you're going to get anywhere,
not really.
That's not the case. So
that's true.
It's great that that book mentions how important reading is, because that's what we're trying to tell people all the time.
So that's a good book on my list.
It's just a perspective change that you need to make, I guess, to kind of bettering yourself.
Right.
Where you're like, I'm going to become the best version of myself at some point in time. So I'm going to keep on trying to get there.
Yes.
And I think a lot of us don't do that consciously enough.
Right.
And in leadership roles, it kind of becomes very important.
It does. In fact, let me share this with you.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So Satya and me, we know each other a long time.
Yeah.
I know you too. But with Satya, it's like we've worked together also and everything. And initially, I used to tell him, Satya, read a book. Read a book. And his favorite used to be Game of Thrones. We used to talk about it. And it makes me feel so proud that he's, running his own publishing and you guys are the open library. So this whole read a book idea, the minute you get into it, there's no looking. I mean, you remember, we used to have
honestly,
this conversation.
Honestly, Zarina, I have to give you the credit here, because I used to only read fiction and fantasy and only Harry Potter and Game of Thrones and all these things only, and I had no interest in non-fiction. And in fact, when we did some work together, I found so much benefit from reading non-fiction books, which I used to hate with
totally
a vigor.
despised it.
For me to actually be doing a podcast that recommends non-fiction books, if you know me from 10 years ago, it sounds ridiculous.
That's why I'm so proud.
And it was just the benefit I got from the books, and I always say this, that the books that I read really helped mold my sort of the way I think about things and the way I react to things now.
Yes.
And it's because it's from so many stalwarts across industries, it's just you have access to their thoughts, and why wouldn't you, right?
Right. And when you read about them, you just realize that, hey, you know what, my journey is not that different, yet
exactly.
It's different.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
If they could do it, so can I.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then you realize in no time that you'll be writing your own book, you know. Oh. It's as simple as that. Everybody's getting into that zone. So it's I really like the whole concept of this whole, the paperback, because idea of promoting reading is so important and so beautiful.
Thank you.
Yes, amazing.
Great. The next book we're moving on to is 60 Second Timeout by Mike Greene.
Right.
So tell us a little bit about this book, Zarina.
This is a very simple read. So usually what happens is, like Satya used to be, you know, we're talking about that then.
Uh-huh.
So I have always come across people who are like, you know, I don't have the time to read, Zarina. I mean, there's so much to do in my life. This is like the last of the things.
Mm-hmm.
And the minute I open a book, I fall asleep.
Mm-hmm.
This is, these are two excuses I often come across.
Mm.
So I like to encourage people to read books which have short stories, quick to understand, and then you move on.
Right.
So let's say in a day, if you've read one chapter, which is two pages long, you probably have a message. You can use it through the week. And you don't have to look back. And maybe that kind of subconsciously gets in somewhere and stays with you.
Right.
Yeah.
So this particular book, The 60 Second Timeout, gives you those short stories.
Okay.
You know, they're just like one or two pages, sharing quick stress busters, quick ways of being positive, and then being better leaders, or how not to procrastinate. So everything in very short, quick manner. So basically what we say, what you guys say, what I'm saying, we reinforce it by giving them a book.
Right.
You know, we're not dealing with people who are 10 and 15.
Right.
And you can't give them, you know, like study material.
Right.
So you tell them, okay, like, just go ahead, read life lessons, and we're on the same track. So this book is, it works very well as complementary to what I am doing in general, and I truly believe in a lot of the things mentioned in this book as well. So,
a great book for even non-readers, I guess, to start getting into the habit of reading.
Yes, because that's the whole idea.
Yeah, again, reading is a habit itself, right? You develop it over time.
That's
a great book to start, I guess.
Right, and especially when people, I mean, me personally, if I go to, so I have a library of my own, and I keep my company stamp on it. I will let people borrow it and give it back to me, because that is my prized possession.
Yeah.
So you go into a crossword, the first thing I do is I go into the areas of self-help or motivation, but I will also see the size of the book.
Right.
I cannot read big books.
Okay.
You know, the size of the book matters to me. And I realize that as a reader, when something like that can happen, people who just don't read, you know, they don't have
daunting task.
Really daunting
like
task.
Climb Everest in the first
literally
book.
Like just look at the book and they're going to be like, okay, you know, this isn't happening. I'm just going to sleep on it. It's more a pillow for me. So
the size is demotivating.
Demotivating. So that's a book you probably should recommend to people who aren't into reading and who are first timers, kind of amateur.
It's just great how it, you know, talks about recalibrating your thoughts before you make any decision, taking 60 seconds, you know,
and
out
absolutely.
And deciding before you make a decision, which sort of, I think in the long run will help you prevent making mistakes.
Oh, I think this is one of the advices that Zarina had also given me. And we've discussed this on her podcast, the Empowering Series with Zarina, where we were actually talking about anger management.
Oh, yes, we were.
How I definitely struggle with it on a daily basis. And one of the top advices given to me by Zarina was that you need to take a minute, think about what you're going to do.
Yeah.
Instead of reacting, think about it
and respond.
Then respond.
Right.
Don't react. You know, a reaction will always be driven by emotion.
Yeah, it's always
reflect. Wow, you remember that. I am impressed. You remember you took the lesson?
Of course.
Yes.
Yeah, but you know, just we want to be very impulsive and vulnerable in a moment of anger or conflict or let's say something's not working out or pressure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So when you take those 60 seconds away, step away from everything, and even if you don't have to be really well conditioned and nourished to perceive things in a better way, all you have to do is just time out.
Yeah. Right.
You know, that's all. Just calm down and go back. That's what you need to do.
It really works, I
gotta
say.
It does, totally.
And the last book that we are discussing today is People's Tools by Alan C. Fox.
So Alan C. Fox, again, there are about 54 different strategies mentioned in this book.
Okay.
Again, short reads.
Okay.
You know.
Great.
Some interesting stories. So I like the idea of storytelling and lesson learning.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
They stay with you.
Yeah.
Kind of longer. So these are good stories, which kind of gives you an idea of what a cat and a fox would do in a particular situation.
Okay.
Or, you know, things like building the cathedral or the Noah's Ark. And so they're using, Alan C. Fox has used some interesting concepts of management and leadership and explained it through some storytelling. So it's pretty interesting.
Yeah, I think the highlight for me in the book were like two points that he mentions. Mm-hmm. One is, you know, when you catch someone being good,
yes,
you should appreciate them.
Absolutely.
Because that leads to repeat behavior.
Right.
And the other one is that, so he talks about nonversation, which is
nonversation. Yes, that's one of his.
You know, talking to a person. So letting a person talk about their woes, their troubles, and not saying anything. And just listening to them, because then that avoids bickering or fighting about something. So, yeah, these are like two concepts I really love about the book.
But the nonversation concept is so interesting and so hard.
For most
people. Like, for example, we're doing this entire podcast and we'll talk about rejection. Maybe we'll talk about listening skills.
Yeah. Right.
But you know what we're expecting is, I mean, I'm going to tell you about how well you should be listening and speak more, speak less, listen more.
Yeah.
And what you actually will be doing is actually listening to me for 1 hour and I'm the one talking.
Right.
Yeah. You know, so sometimes it is so ironic what you're trying to express to somebody and how you express it.
Yeah.
You know,
it's like
so
I'm talking to you, but you listen.
You listen. But this is about listening more, okay, guys?
So
the whole concept, it's so interesting. Nonversation also comes under that category of things, except that the idea is to avoid conflict.
Right?
And I think when you avoid conflict, the choices you make and the consequences following those choices become much better.
Yeah, I think it just relates back to the 60 seconds time
out. Oh, yes, it does.
Sure.
That you're taking that time out, letting the person
talk,
and then you probably make a better decision.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So all the books kind of are intertwined.
Yeah.
And they are because
there's a common theme running through this episode.
Yes. And the common theme is because I think affirmation, like we're talking about, you know, that requires repetition.
Right.
So the more you repeat it, the more you see it in different forms, different ways, you want to believe it, you want to achieve it. So I guess that repetition somewhere slips into the books and this episode and all of us.
Great. Thank you, Zarina Poonawalla, for being with us today and sharing your insights on these books. We look forward to having you on the show again.
Thank you so much, Racheta and Satyajit, for having me on your show. And
it was
absolutely
a delight.
Look forward to coming back whenever you want me to.
Awesome.
Yes. And yes, I'm also looking forward to you guys listening to your show when it comes out on the Empowering Series with Zarina. And
can't wait.
Yes,
can't wait for
yes,
that one.
Yes. So we'll have a lot to discuss later then.
Awesome.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And a big thank you to all our listeners. You can follow the Open Library Project on LinkedIn, Instagram and Facebook for latest updates on our events. And stay tuned for the next Paperback podcast on IVM Podcasts. Happy reading. You can follow IVM Podcasts on Facebook, Instagram and Twitter at IVM Podcasts. Listen to Paperback on the IVM Podcast app, website or wherever you listen to podcasts.
How does one separate news from opinion? I'm Mahrukh Inayat, a news junkie, but not a big fan of debates. I love facts, and I like to stick to them. No frills, just pure analysis. This election season, is Balakot a game changer for 2019? Did Priyanka Gandhi Vadra join politics too late? The Chowkidar Wars, who's really winning? I will cut the clutter and analyze the stories that matter to you.
You can listen to the show on the IVM Podcasts app or wherever you get your podcasts.
How many times have you motivated yourself to improve your sleep or lose weight or be more productive? How many times have you failed? Hi, my name is Ashton Doctor. Tune into my show, The Habit Coach Podcast, where we focus on creating small, tiny habits to improve your life instead of those big, impossible tasks. So make listening to me a habit every Monday, Wednesday and Friday on the IVM Podcast app or ivmpodcast.com or on your favorite podcasting app.